I believe this is an important word today, because whenever there's one that's really, really important, I don't sleep well. Because there are certain things that the enemy of our soul really, really, really does not want us to hear. And so, Lord, I'm praying that this goes into our spirit like a sword. Lord, I pray that we walk out of here today free. We walk out of here today more prepared than before, more filled with you than before, more able to receive and be with you than before. Come, Jesus. A couple of weeks ago, I had one of those troubling dreams that stayed with me for a couple of days. And in this dream, New Song had a new building. And the new building was a huge mansion. I mean, a really rich, huge mansion. It was elaborately decorated, very richly decorated. I mean, you would have thought of it as a palace. Had a beautiful lounge area with a kitchen and a bar near the front door. No alcohol in the bar. Large rooms that were full of light and beauty. And the service had ended, and the place was emptying out. But among the ones who were lingering was one person who was dirty and foul and disruptive and wouldn't listen, and I told him to leave. And he went out the door, but he came right back in, and I told him to leave again. And by that time, I'm angry. I mean, I am really angry. I don't do anger well, but I was really angry. I kept kicking him out over and over again. But people kept, he'd leave the building, but people kept leaving doors and windows open or doors unlocked, and he kept coming back in until I was angry with people for not paying attention to the security of the building. And finally, I put him out the front door. There was a group of people out on the lawn of this building having some kind of a gathering. And I told this guy, you don't just get out of the building. You get off the property. I don't ever want to see you on this property again. If I ever see you on this property again, we're going to call the police. What does that dream mean? God has been doing something in our midst in these recent months. And Nathan and I both have been preaching into it. He's been doing something in these recent months that, in my opinion, is beyond special. It's holy. It's clean. It's full of love. I've never felt anything like it, especially last week. And I've lived through everything from the charismatic renewal to the Jesus movement to the Vineyard, Toronto. I've been through all of those things. I've never felt anything like what God has begun to pour out here. There's something really different about it. Now, a major focus of our church along the way has been the Father's heart, right from the beginning, seeking and plumbing the depths of His love and helping people connect with the Father's love. And God has responded. He's responded with revelation, and He's responded with healing, and He's responded with understanding. And then, as I was thinking about that, I thought, well, maybe a better way to put that is that He moved to reveal Himself, and we responded. It's been His grace. It's been His goodness. Because we couldn't have done that on our own. And if we ever think that we did it on our own, it's over. Couldn't have done it on our own. And that touch, that revelation from Him, it's affected everything we do. It's changed the way we pray. It's changed our worship. It's infected all of our ministries in a beautiful way. It's changed our relationships with one another. And so there's this sweet, simple purity in all of this. It's a purity of focus. It's a desire to be intimate with Jesus and to be intimate with the Father, to be in their presence. There's this richness, there's a beauty and a peace and a joy in it. That's the mansion in my dream. But it has to be guarded. It has to be protected. Same way that you would guard or protect a treasure that you would have in your house. Defilement and disruption cannot be allowed to pollute that. I want us to be in Him. In Him. And I don't ever, 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 ever want to leave that presence. I want to walk it. I want to breathe it. I want to know it. I want to feel it. I want to shine it out in the world, and I don't want to do anything. I don't want to be anything that would hinder or diminish that in any way. that comes to mind as I'm saying all this is that a number of years ago, Nathan asked me, he said, "Dad, if you had a choice between the presence of God and a church with thousands of people, which would you choose?" And I said, "I would choose the presence of God every time, every time. I want Him." And what God was telling me in the dream is that holiness matters. There's a lot of teaching out there today that wants us to believe that holiness doesn't matter, that somehow the grace of God just covers everything. We don't have to worry about being holy. Holiness matters. And we've come to a place and a time as a people in which we can at last understand what God really means by holiness. Holiness is one of those words that has left our Christian vocabulary, partly because it's been misunderstood over the years, and it's been misapplied. It's been used by a lot of people to hurt people, to issue condemnations. But it's time for us to recover the truth. And I hope you came prepared to hear it today, because this is, I say this too often, but I think this is one of the most important words I may have ever given. I want us to understand what holiness is and why. Because in reality, holiness is good. Holiness is freedom. Holiness is joy. Holiness is blessing. Holiness is fulfillment. My dream says that we've come into a time when we can't any longer leave doors and windows open for defilement to get into our lives, or for the focus on Jesus to shift, even in the slightest degree. Small compromises, small pollutions make big access points for disruption and for decay. It can keep getting in, and we have to keep putting it out over and over again. I'd rather not spend the energy. Holiness matters. And so for myself, in my own life, I'm closing some access points that I've left open. I don't want them anymore. I'm going to where God is taking me. I'm going to where God has taken me. And I'm so hungry for that because it's so good. I can't afford to have even those small things depositing dirt in my life. Each grain of dirt diminishes. Each grain of dirt diminishes the sense of what I'm seeking and what I'm receiving. Every little bit. I can't afford defilement through what I let my eyes see. Even if I'm strong enough to filter it out, I can't afford to spend the energy. I can't afford defilement in what I allow my heart to feel about life or about you or God or the words that I say. Now, what I'm talking about is not a legalism. This is not an effort of the flesh. This is not a set of old ideas and stupid religious rules that imprison people. That's not what it's about. When I was in college in southern Idaho, I attended the College of Idaho. It was a private school, Presbyterian school, pretty liberal. 6 miles away from us was a college called Northwest Nazarene. And Northwest Nazarene, their idea of holiness was you don't go to movies, you don't play cards, you don't go on dates unchaperoned, all that stuff. And they would actually, we made fun of them. I have to repent of that today, but we made fun of them. Because they would actually send posses out to the movie theaters to catch their students breaking the rules. They had dorm hours, we didn't. People, that's not holiness, that's legalism. 1977, a lot of Christians refused to see Star Wars because they thought it was unholy, because the Force misrepresented God. And it made them feel oh so righteous and important. That's not holiness. Some people right now won't see The Shack because of a couple of minor theological flaws. And they think that's what it is to be holy. That's not holiness. That's a prison that sucks the joy out of life. Walking in holiness means reflecting and living the heart of God. It means that some things taste really bad next to the goodness of what God's doing. I need focus. I want the glory. Holiness means you come to a place in your life where it's kind of like Beth saying, like Beth saying, I can't eat cabbage. I'm allergic to it. Well, why not eat cabbage? Well, because of its effect. Because it kills and it defiles and it makes her system sick. Beth can't even smell cabbage when it's cooking without getting sick. Figuratively speaking, I wonder how many smells there are in the world that you and I play with, not realizing that because of who we are in the Lord, we are actually allergic to it and we end up sick or hindered or diminished in our sense of God. Yeah? Last week I talked about the fire of God. I talked about the fire of God being judgment and cleansing. The fire of God in the sacrificial offering. I talked about fire as the presence of God. I want all of that for me. I want all of that for you. I don't want to stop short. I'm not interested in a nice church. I've said that so many times. So does holiness still matter? What does it mean? And what is it and how far does it go? How many of you figured out yet that Jesus had some really disturbing things to say? I mean, really. He started out with something sounded kind of nice. Beginning of the book of Matthew, Matthew 5:8, he said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. That sounded kind of nice. That's blessed are the pure in heart. Greek word is katharos, means physical, religious, moral purity. To be clean, to be emptied, innocent. Uncleanness was actually seen as a power in itself that would defile. So the holiness of God includes moral cleanness, moral purity. God himself is absolutely moral. I want to fully experience God. So I want anything that isn't morally pure, I want anything that isn't innocent out of me. I want out of me anything that doesn't flow from his love, anything that doesn't flow from his goodness. I want to close the doors and the windows in my life that let defiled things climb back in again and again. Here's one of those disturbing statements. Matthew chapter 4 starts at verse 44. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. That's disturbing by itself. So that you may be sons of your Father who's in heaven. For he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? If you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? And here's the verse. Therefore, you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Well, hello, I'm screwed. I mean, that ought to sober you up. You must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. What's that about? Well, at the very least, I know that it's about love. That's the context. That's the focus of these verses. It's about loving even those who are really hard to love. But I'm a mess. So are you. But we're being changed. And we're learning. Matthew 5:19 and 20. Whoever then annuls one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever keeps and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And here's the verse. For I say to you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. In other words, you won't experience the power of the kingdom of God come to earth. You won't experience the purity of his presence. You won't experience his will made real among us here. And then what follows these verses is all about not allowing anger or disrespect or division between brothers to continue. Because it isn't love. It would be defilement. You don't let it continue. No matter what it is, you don't let it continue. See, we've been called to love. We've been called to purity. Now, the Jews hearing this, they would say, how could anybody be more holy than a scribe or a Pharisee? Scribes were the teachers of the law. They were the interpreters of the scriptural law. The Pharisees were the ones who meticulously obeyed every little bitty rule the scribes said that they should be doing. Pharisees, are they holy? Well, they didn't fornicate. They didn't commit adultery. They tithed 10% even of the garden herbs that they grew in their yards. 10% of whatever they grew. They didn't lie. They legalistically stopped to pray wherever they were at the three prescribed prayer times during the day for the Jews. They observed the Sabbath in the temple and the synagogue. They didn't eat unclean foods. There were no pigs, no scaleless fish. They ritually washed their hands before meals in the way the scribes told them to. They gave alms to the poor. And Jesus says, we have to be more righteous than that. We have to be better than that. And the heart of it, over and over again, is that it's about purity of love. And then when you get to issues of purity and morality, or even purity in the tithe, it's still all about love. And it's all about intimacy with God. Scribes and Pharisees thought their religious obedience made them righteous by their own effort. Look how good we are. Christians know that leads no place. Figure that one out yet? Righteousness and holiness come only from Jesus. There's nothing in me. He washed, he cleansed us at the cross. He gave us his holiness, gave us his purity to wear, to walk in. 2 Corinthians 3:18. Still talking holiness. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit. So my purity, my holiness, my changes come from looking into the face of Jesus and never looking away. His goodness transforms me. Why would I want to defile that? Why would I ever want to look away? Does holiness still matter? There's some sitting in this room today, I am pleading with you. The Pharisees in Jesus' day, Christians who practice legalistic holiness today, think that not doing certain things makes them holy. I want you to understand something. This might be the most important thing I say today. Nothing that I do or don't do makes me or you holy. Not one thing that we can ever not do or do makes us holy or unholy. Why? I'm already holy. And so are you. You're never going to be holier. If you gave your life to Jesus, you're never going to be holier than you are today. Jesus made us holy. We can't add to that. We can't take anything away from it. It's done. His blood, his sacrifice, his resurrection, his goodness, we've been chosen, called, washed, cleansed, and made holy. Not looking at pornography doesn't make me holy. I'm already holy. Looking at pornography doesn't make me unholy. It only defiles what was made holy by Jesus. Listen. Yep, it defiles what was made holy by Jesus. And Jesus said things like, don't take what's holy and throw it to the dogs. Sex is holy. 1 Corinthians 3:16, 17. Do you not know that you are a temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If any man destroys the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, and that is what you are. Now, in context, Paul was talking about sexual immorality. He was talking about the damage that sexual immorality does to the core of you. Why do you want to defile or pollute what Jesus has made holy and clean? So at root, holy, hagios in the original Greek, means set aside. It means designated for a certain purpose, not to be used for any other purpose. The fire pans and things that were used in Solomon's temple and in the later temple, those were holy. They were to be used only for those things. You didn't take them home, cook breakfast in them. Because they were holy. They were set aside. You and I are holy. We've been set aside. designated for a certain purpose. You can't change that if you came to Jesus. You can only defile it. You can only misuse what you are. And so, what Paul said was about sexual immorality, but what he said applies to anything we're doing to ourselves physically, to our bodies, that have been designated as holy for the Lord's purposes alone. I don't smoke. I haven't smoked since I was 19 years old. Before that, I'd smoke anything that burned. But I haven't smoked since I was 19 years old. Not smoking doesn't make you holy. You're already holy in Jesus. Smoking only defiles and damages what is already holy. And because your body and your spirit are one, and because one affects the other, you're hindering the purity of your intimacy with God, and it's a bad trade. Why do you want to defile what's holy? Not getting high, not getting drunk doesn't make you holy. You're already holy. Doing those things only defiles what is already holy. And what you've done is you've thrown open a window and you've invited the unclean into your innermost self. That hinders the purity of your experience of God. It's a bad trade. What is holy is set aside for a specific purpose. And because it is holy, it must not be used for any other purpose than the purpose for which it was designed. Otherwise, goodness is lost. Glory is hindered. The joy is diminished. You and I are created in God's image, created to reflect Him, created to inherit with Jesus. We're created to be sons and daughters. God created us good, and His image remains. You can't erase the image of God in any human being. You can only defile it or break it or obscure it. But the image remains. God is love. That's what we were designed for. If we're going to reflect His image, it's what we were made for. As Christians, we've been chosen by God. We've been set aside for the purpose of reflecting who He is in love. We've been made holy, cleansed by the blood of Jesus that was shed at the cross. Why defile it with strife or hatred or prejudice or criticism or disrespect or dishonor? Why? Love doesn't, by the way, love doesn't make us holy. We love because we are holy. And when we don't love, it doesn't make us unholy. It only defiles and obscures and pollutes what's already holy. I've been faithful to my wife for 44 and a half years. And if you add our engagement into it, that's 45 or more. That doesn't make me holy. I'm already holy. I was cleansed. I was chosen by what Jesus did for me at the cross the moment that I received Him. To defile that, listen to me, to defile that would be taking my own life. Might as well put a gun to my head and pull the trigger or drink poison. I was chosen by God. I had received Jesus. This is one of the crazy things. People do these things. I did these things. I was chosen by God and had received Jesus before I illegally put my hands on the first girl I messed around with. That was serious brain damage. When I did that, I defiled what is holy. And I felt the impact of it. I damaged myself at the core of who I am. And it took a long time to heal. And it wasn't that God was angry with me. It wasn't that God was up there just waiting to hand down a punishment. He didn't reject me. Sometimes sin is its own punishment. We reap what we sow. And what I reaped in hurt, what I reaped in destruction, was God's loving discipline to build righteousness into me, to change my character so that I could live in the glory. And so I've been faithful to my wife since the day we became a couple, because Jesus called us, and Jesus made us holy, and our relationship is holy. It's set aside for God's purposes, and I cannot defile the glory of that. Our communication is holy. Our sexuality is holy and glorious. Why would I defile that? Why? Thus, in my oneness reflects His oneness, His image. But if I were to falter in my faithfulness to Beth, it'll never happen. She'd kill me anyway. But if I were to falter in my faithfulness to Beth, it would not make me unholy. It would only defile what is already holy. It would defile me at the core of who I am. Something at the core of who I am would be broken. And my relationship with God and with her would be damaged. I'd be destroying myself. I'd be destroying my own spirit. And I'd be robbing her. And the very thought of that makes me sick. The thought of doing drugs makes me sick. The thought of getting drunk makes me sick. The thought of getting high makes me sick. The thought of lying makes me sick. Hatred makes me sick. And the list goes on. Because those things defile the goodness that I've been given. It defiles the holiness that Jesus has put on me. Holiness matters. Grace does not erase that. Now take a fresh look. Romans. We read Romans 12, 1 and 2 last week. I want you to take a fresh look at that in light of what I'm saying. Listen. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Real holiness proves that God is good. Real holiness proves that His words are good. Because in His holiness, life is good. Life is blessed. Life is joyous. I've learned that if my life, this might upset some of you, I've learned that if my life is a wreck, and if I'm walking in persistent pain over a long period of time, there's probably some area of it in which I've let in a defilement of some kind. It might be one of those moral issues. It might be some kind of ungodly belief about myself or about God. It might be an insecurity that blinds me and defiles my relationships. It might be some element of unforgiveness that I'm holding towards somebody or a judgment about someone else's nature or character. It might be an old fear that doesn't line up with trust. It might be a bitterness or a negativity that's not been released, but it will be there somewhere. Ephesians 1, 4 through 6. Just as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before Him. In love, He predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus. I say this a lot. If you're sitting here and you know Jesus, you are absolutely privileged and loved because God chose you before He created the world. And that's why you're here. Doesn't make any difference what you did in the other parts of your life. He chose you before He created the world. Predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the kind intention of His will, to the praise of the glory of His grace, which He freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. Now that's an established fact. It cannot be changed. We're holy and beloved. That can't be changed. Those two things, holy and loved, they come together. I'm already holy and I'm always loved. You're already holy if you've received Jesus. You're already adopted. You're already set aside for God's purposes. Why would I ever want to defile that? How could anything be better than that? Why would I ever want to diminish that or obscure that? Hope this is going in because it's one of those days I'm not getting a lot of loud amens. God is so good. He loves me deeply. Why would I want to dull my senses of Him? Hear me in this. Religion makes rules and it hands down condemnations for breaking the rules. Holiness is different. In real holiness, I don't need to condemn anybody else for their compromises. In real holiness, I can only hurt for the damage that people do to themselves. And that's one of the things that really sucks about being a pastor. See, I can only have compassion for the destruction and the loss and the pain. Colossians 1, 21, 22. We're doing a lot of scripture today. And although you were formerly alienated, hostile in mind, engaged in evil deeds, yet he has now reconciled you in his fleshly body through death in order to present you before him holy and blameless, beyond reproach. Chapter 3, verse 12. So as those who've been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another, forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. That's holiness. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of a heavenly calling, every person sitting in this room who's given him or herself to Jesus is holy, set aside for a heavenly purpose, for a heavenly calling. We are sharers in a common destiny. We can only do it together. Can't do it alone. We can only do it together. Real holiness is first a gift, and second, it's the decision about how I'm going to live. 1 Peter 1:15, like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it's written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. If I'm a child of God and he's holy, so am I. 1 Peter 2:4-5. By coming to him as to a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Verse 9, same chapter. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. We've been set aside. A holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Those in this world who buy into the lie of cheap grace, that God is so loving, it doesn't matter what I do, the lie that I can live a loose life and it's all okay and I never need to repent again because Jesus took care of it, people that buy into that will miss all of what I've been saying. Miss the glory, miss the power, miss the love, miss the blessing, miss the sense of God's presence. It won't be there. Defilement and compromise won't change the fact that they are holy. Jesus made them holy, but it's going to shield out or diminish the glory and the blessing. It'll block out the full manifestation of the kingdom of God. Holiness matters. It'll damage the beauty that God created. You realize, a lot of people don't realize this, you realize you can damage your spirit in the same way you can damage your physical body? You can wound your spirit in the same way you can wound your spiritual body. You realize it takes time to heal that damage in the same way it takes time to heal your body? How many of you know that if you get a sore or a cut on your nose, it can overshadow the health of the rest of your whole body? Your whole body will feel that pain. It's all you can think about, right? Yeah. Stub your toe. That's a little thing. How does the rest of your body feel? You do one small wound to your spirit, and it will affect everything you are. You damage your spirit in one way, it will affect everything about the rest of you. Your emotions, your sense of God, everything. So we seek purity. And we're seeking purity not to earn anything. We're seeking purity to stay healthy. We're seeking purity to keep open our sense of the incredible presence and love of God. 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him because we will see him just as he is. There's that connection again. You see Jesus and you're changed to be as he is. Verse 3, and everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he is pure. Right now, and over recent weeks, there's a purity, there's a holiness in our worship. There's a purity and a holiness in our ministry that God has been bringing to us. And we're changed as we fill our vision with him and as we refuse to look away. That worship's not about ambition. It's not about anybody being noticed. For me, it's simple, it's sweet, it's just him. And I believe it's the heart of the revival that God is sending and wants to send. I've never sensed anything like it in any of the moves of the Spirit that I've lived through. Now, in all of this, listen carefully. We want to be careful to offer pure sacrifices to the Lord. We don't want to offer what the Bible calls strange fire. There's that odd passage. It comes up more than once in the Old Testament about strange fire. One of them is Leviticus 10, 1 and 2. Nadab, we say Nadab, they would say Nadab, and Avihu, the sons of Aaron, took their respective fire pans, and after putting fire in them, placed incense on it and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. And fire came out from the presence of the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. Well, that's a troubling one, isn't it? God isn't just a father. He is a king. And kings require protocol when you approach them. Strange fire is fire of sacrifice that God didn't call for and that doesn't fit God's protocol. We no longer offer burnt offerings of animals and produce. Instead, we offer ourselves as burnt offerings to the Lord, holy, acceptable. We offer sacrifices of praise and thanksgiving. So what makes for strange fire with us today? And this is where I want to go in worship. Our offerings have to be holy and pure. Our worship can't have anybody's personal ambition in it. Can't have anybody's need to be seen in it. It can't be about the musicians. It can't be about personal dedication to the one leading. It can't be about trying to get something out of it for ourselves. It can't be about fleshly hype. Those are impurities. Those are unholy pollutions. It can't be about trying to work something up or make something happen. It can't be about being crazy in worship just because that's what we think it should look like or because that's what everybody else is doing. It has to be what Jesus is doing. It has to be real. It has to be a focus on him. Those other things, those are strange fire that God didn't call for. And so it has to be real. It has to be about real time in love together with our Lord. So there's an altar call today. And I'm serious with this. I'm desperate in my spirit with this. Because I know how most Christians live. It's a call for purity. It's a call for cleansing whatever we have allowed to defile the holiness that we've been given. What windows and doors have I left open for the purity of God's presence with me, for the purity of my holiness to be defiled? In what ways have I used or been using this for purposes it was not designed for? It's confession of sin. It's confession. It's for repentance. It's for freedom in what we've been given. It's for the release of real revival as we sense and we drink the fullness of God. It's for love of God. It's for healing of the damage we do to the glory. Get that. It's for healing of the damage that we have done to the glory that God has given. What he's made in each one of us. Some of us have been carrying that unhealed wound in the spirit for a long time. It's time for it to be sealed today. It's time for defilement to go. It's time for the mansion to be locked. So I want to do an old vineyard song. I can't think of a better one. It's a refiner's fire. And I want to call some ministry team people up here. And I think an important scripture today is confess your sins to one another, and pray for one another that you may be healed. So this altar is open today. You're going to close a window, you're going to heal up an old spiritual wound, you're going to come before the Lord in repentance for something that's been carried in the heart or something that you've been compromising with. You're going to walk out of here different today. We're going to have a purity of the Lord's presence. We're not going to defile what He's given. Does that make sense to everyone? Yes. Amen. This is serious. We're at a turning point in our church. And this is a key to that.
Father, I see your hand upon